Friends, how you doing there? Welcome back to Babylon Talmud. Today we're starting Daf Nun, Daf 50 of Masechta Ksubis. Friends, Daf 50 talks about stuff. What do you want me to tell you? What do you want me to tell you? Stuff. Talks about Mizonis, things, stuff, things and stuff. And alright. So, we're going to start on Daf, I sure hope we got up to Daf Nun. I'm pretty sure we did. Yeah. Daf Nun, Omar Aleph, 3 lines into the page. Omar Rabbi Illa, says Rabbi Illa, Be'usha Iskinu, they had an Usha they established. Hamevazbez al yevazbez yosu michomesh. Interesting. That a fellow, when he gives charity, shouldn't give away more than 20% of his wealth. Tananam Yochi, we also learn advice like this. Hamevazbez al yevazbez yosu michomesh. That if a fellow gives away charity, he shouldn't give more than 20% of his wealth in charity. Shemi yitzarech labrius. Because if he gives away too much of his money, then maybe he's going to be next. He's going to require charity. So 20% is kind of the upper limit of how much you should give away. There was a story regarding a fellow who wanted to give away more than 20% of his wealth. But his friend didn't let him. Who's the friend? Umanu? Rabbi Yeshviv. His friend was Rabbi Yeshviv. You know where Rabbi Yeshviv HaSofer was? He was one of the Asarei Gemachos. I assume that that's what it's talking about. Ve'amrei lo Rabbi Yeshviv ve'lo yinicho chaver umanu Rabbi Akiva. Now those who say, no, it's Rabbi Yeshviv who wanted to give away more than 20% of his wealth, and his friend Rabbi Akiva didn't allow him. Both Rabbi Yeshviv HaSofer and Rabbi Akiva were from the Asarei Gemachos, killed by the Romans. Amrei Nachman says, Nachman b'tem Rav Acha bar Yaakov. Mikra, where do we have a pasuk that teaches that a fellow shouldn't give away more than 20% of his wealth? That anything that you give me, I will give asera asvenu. That I will. Who says this? I think that's Yaakov Avinu. I think said that. And anything that you give me, asera asvenu loch, I will. You know, eser is 10. Asera asvenu. So 10 times 2. It says aser and asvenu, so it's like 10 and 10 is 20%. V'halo dami yisur basu yisur kamo. So now the Gemara says, wait a second. If I start with $100 and then I take 10% of that, so I'm left with 90. If I take 10% of that, I'm left with 81. So it's not 20%; it's really 19%, because the second 10% is less than the first 10%. And Ravashi says, Ravashi, Asvenu Levasa Kikama. So Aser Asvenu means Asvenu Levasa. I will take my second tenth at the same measure as the first tenth. I.e., I will take 20%, not 19%. And Rav Shimon Barashi, Shmuel Salol, Mismaites, Vauches, Visimarach Tan, Kosu, Vizbizu. Alright, fine. That we mentioned Rabbi Illa 3 times in the past, Amud. The first time he mentioned in the name of Rish Lakish, the name of Yehuda, of Rabbi Yosef, Rabbi Chanina. Second time was only the name of Rish Lakish. This time he said in his own name. Each time Rabbi Illa mentioned something, there was one less Amora in the chain. So it says, Shmuel Salalu Mismaites Volchus, that each one of these teachings, kind of there was one less Amora on the chain. Okay, fine. And then he gives you some way to remember the 3 things. Fine. Omer Yitzchok says Rav Yitzchok beUsha iskinu, that they enacted in Usha shei adam is galgal and bnu ad shteim esrei shone. Now, if a fellow has a son, so for the first 12 years of his life, he could be chill with his son. The son doesn't, you know, want to learn Torah yet. All right, it's cool. But mikan veelach. But at 12 years old, the buck stops here. I think that's the phrase. Yored imo l'chayv, he rips his head off. So if the yingle doesn't want to learn until 12, Seder. Comes 12 years old. If that yingle doesn't want to learn, we rip his head off. That's how we get him to learn. Ini, is that so? Ve'omer le Rav, Rav Shmuel Bar Shilas. But Rav said to Rav Shmuel Bar Shilas, and Rashi says Rav Shmuel Bar Shilas was a melamed tinoikis. He was a Rebbe. Batsumi Barshis, lo sagbil. Don't accept students that are less than 6 years old. Barshis, kabil v'safir le ketura. But once they are 6 years old, on the other hand, accept them into your cheder and force feed them Torah like an ox. Force feed them Torah like an ox. So, one says, on the one hand, we're saying that you wait until 12 before ripping off his head. And on the other hand, we're saying that already at 6 years old, we force feed him Torah like an ox. So, in Safer de Keturah, Mi Inu Yoridim Olechayev. Well, yeah, at 6 already, we start force feeding him Torah like an ox. But we wait another 6 years until he's 12, until we rip his head off. Alachash Tim Esrei Shana. Fine. Right. We only rip his head off after 12 years old. If you want, I will say, Lekasha al-Mikol al-Mishnah. So it depends. If we're talking about Tanakh, or if we're talking about Mishnayis. If we're talking about Tanakh, so already at 6 years old, we start force feeding him Tanakh like an ox. But in terms of Mishnayis, we only rip his head off to study Mishnayis at 12 years old. Tomer Abai says, Abai Omerli Aim, that my nurse told me, Bar Shis LeMikud, that at 6 years old, you start studying Tanakh, Bar Eser LeMishneh, and at 10 years old, you start learning Mishnayis, but then at 12 years old, we rip your head off if you don't learn Mishnayis. Bar Tleis LeTanisa, and once you're 13, you start fasting, Me'es Le'es, for 24 hours, with Tinokas Bas Tracer, and girls from already 12 years old. Okay, fine. Omer Abai says, Abai Omer Li Aim, that my nurse told me, Hai Bar Shiz De Tarkalei Akrov B'Yom D'Mishlam Shiz, that if you have a 6-year-old fellow who gets bitten by a scorpion on the day that he turns 6, Lo Chaya, he won't live. Maya Susei, what kind of emergency remedy can you do to prevent him from dying? Mirarta Didaya, the bile of a vulture, Chivarta, of a white vulture, B'Shichra, with beer, Neshafye V'Nashkaye, so, rub the bile of the white vulture on the wound, on the bite, and then give him beer to drink. Hai Bashata, a 1-year-old baby, the Tarik Le Zibur, that was stung by a bee, Biyoma de Mishlam Shata, on the day that he turns 1, Lochai won't live. Maya Susei, what kind of emergency medicine can you do to keep him alive? Atsusa de Dikla Bimaya, the bast of a palm tree with water. Neshafi Vineshkaye, rub the bast of the palm tree on the fellow, on the sting, and then give him water to drink, and the fellow will be all right. Omar Rav Katina says, Rav Katina called Amachna says, B'no pochis mi ben sheish, that if a fellow teaches Torah to his yingle less than 6 years old, rotz achar ve'enu magio, well, Torah makes you weak. It makes you weak. It's draining. It's a lot of effort. And this little fellow, who his father is trying to teach him Torah when he's less than 6 years old, he's going to be very weak and he can get sick. It can be dangerous. And his father is always going to be running after him to try to help him, Veinu Magio, but he's not going to succeed because it's very dangerous stuff to study Torah less than 6. Yikudami chaver rotzen achorav. Ve'en magin also. But others taka say punkt faket. Well, not necessarily punkt faket, but in a different light, which is, no, if a fellow starts learning very young, less than 6 years old, he mamish is having a gewaltiger head start. His friends are going to try to catch up to him, but they won't be able to. V'tavayu isnu, and you could say both are true. Cholish v'gomer. He'll be a weak fellow, but he'll be wicked smart. He'll be a big, big Talmud Chochum. Okay, fine. Yibay sema adukachish adabari. Or alternatively, you can explain, well, if the kid is already weak, then if he starts learning less than 6, and he's already weak to begin with, well, then he might get very weak, and his father's always going to be trying to help him, and it's going to be difficult. But if he's a healthy yingle, so then if he gets a head start, less than 6 years old, it's going to be very challenging for his friends to catch up to his greatness. Givaldi. Omer Rabbi Yossi Bar Chanina says, Rabbi Yossi Bar Chanina, Be'usha iskinu, that they made a takone in enactment in Usha, Ha'isha shemochu b'nichzei melug, b'chai b'aylo. V'amesa ba'amotz me'ara l'kuchis. Friends, what? Who can tell me what this means? Alright, let me first yawn and stretch. 1 second. Yawn. Stretch. Alrighty. Okay, here we go. It's not that hard. Okay, nu, who can tell me what nichzei melug are? So, Nichsei Malug are like property that a wife inherits that as part of the marriage, they belong to her. Right? It's not part of her dowry. They're property that the wife inherited and they belong to her. But the husband can eat from the fruits, right? So they belong to her. So if it's a field, you know, if it's a piece of property and, you know, they get divorced or he dies and now she has this property and it doubled, tripled in value, gewaldig. She made money on that investment. It's her field, right? If it goes up, if it goes down, she, the gain is hers, the loss is hers, you know, just like, real estate. Fine. Now the thing is, the husband can eat the fruits during this time. Okay, so if it's an apple orchard, the husband can eat the apples. Fine. So now, the thing is, because the husband can eat the apples, we treat him like a lakoch. We treat him like a buyer of the property. And therefore, she's unable to sell this property to somebody else because it's like they were purchased by the husband. So she's not allowed to sell it to somebody else, is the point. So Amar, Reb Yosi bar Chanino, Beusha Eskino, they made an enactment in Usha, Isha Shemacho b'nichse meluk b'chai baila, that if a wife sold her nichse melug when her husband was alive, vamesa, and then she dies, so then if the wife dies, the husband inherits the nichse melug from her. Haba motz miyad alakuchis. Well, she had sold the nichse melug, but she wasn't allowed to, so the husband could chaparain this property that his wife sold and get it back. Because he was the original owner. Ashkechei Rav Yitzchok by Yosef le Rav Abou. So Yitzchok by Yosef found Rav Abou that have koi ba uchlusa de Usha, that he was among the people in Usha. Amale, and he says to Rav Abou, man mor de shmaita de Usha. Who's the one who taught this halacha from Usha about this wife who sold the nichse milog? Amale Rav Yosef bar Chanina. He says it's Rav Yosef bar Chanina. Tanamini arba in Zimnen. And then Rav Yitzchok bar Yosef learned this from Abba 40 times. And it was like he put it in his pocket. It was so clear to him, this halacha, that if the wife sells the nichse melug and then she dies, and the husband can chap it around from the person that it was sold to. I think that the Torah is making me tired over here. All right, or maybe I'm just tired for other reasons. Let's go weiter. Ashrei shomer mishpato tzedakos b'choles. Okay. That fortunate is the people who guard justice and they do charity at all times. V'chi'efshir l'asot tzedakos b'choles. Is it possible to do charity at all times? Darsh Rabbi Sinai Shabiyavne v'amri l'Rab Eliezer. So the rabbis in Yavne, some say it was Rabbi Eliezer, they taught Ze'azon, they expounded Ze'azon banu v'vnosov k'sheng tanim. This is referring to a fellow who sustains, supports his sons and daughters when they are young. That kilu, it's like all the time he's sustaining them. And he's doing for them charity. Rabbi Shmuel bar Nachmani, Omar, says Rabbi Shmuel bar Nachmani, Ze'amigadu yosim v'yisom v'sochbesu masiyon. That somebody raises an orphan, male, female orphan, in his house and marries them off, that is something that's considered tzedakah b'choles, charity at all times. Hon v'oshi b'beisuv tzedkaso medesload, wealth in his house and his righteousness stands forever. Rav Huna v'Rav Chizde, chad omer ze alomi Torah melamde, that's somebody who studies Torah and teaches it. V'chad omer ze akosev Torah nevim uchsuv mashin lachem, that's somebody who writes scrolls from, you know, Sefer Torah, Nevi'im, Ksuvim, and he lends them out to people. That having grandchildren will bring a peace upon Israel. Amr B'Yishuv Ben Levi says, B'Yishuv Ben Levi came in Shabbanim L'Vanecha Shalom HaYisrael. Once your children have children, send Shalom HaYisrael to L'Osid Adei Chalitza V'Yibim. They don't have to worry about Yibim and Chalitza anymore, right? So meaning even once they're married, then you still have to worry about Yibim and Chalitza. But once they have children, there's no longer Yibim and Chalitza. You don't have to worry about that whole mess anymore. Rav Shmuel bar Nachmani Omar, Kim Chabanim Levanecho Shalom Madan Yonin Yisrael Tlo Osid In Tsuye. That once your children have their own children, then it makes things simpler for the judges, because inheritance becomes easier. That they don't have to figure out who's the next heir. Although I saw in the article that they taka asakasha, that I mean there's clearly delineated halachos about who inherits, so like I don't understand necessarily what's so complicated. We know who would get what, but okay, apparently once you have children, you don't have to worry about who's the closest there, because b'meile, the inheritance goes to the children. All right, fine. The Medrash Darsha Elazar Lefnei Chacham V'chulei. So the Mishnah had said that this was the Medrash of Elazar ben Azariah taught before the rabbis in Karen B'Yavne, that just like the sons inherit after the father dies, the Ksubas Benin Dichrin. So also the daughter, excuse me. Well, I just have to yawn again. Also the daughter, when it says that she can chaparan mizonis, that's also after the father dies. Yosef of Yosef kamed of Amnuna. Rav Yosef was sitting before of Amnuna. V'Yosef of Amnuna v'kalmar. And Rav Amnuna said, k'shem she'en abonim yoshin elim na'karke. Just like the sons only inherit their father from property, kach in abonis nizonis elim na'karke. So also the daughters only get their mizonis, their sustenance, after the father dies from property. Ovash ole kuli ama, and everybody got all worked up and upset with Rav Amnuna. De shavik ara hu de yarse le bone, de lo shavik ara lo yarse le bone. They all got upset at Rav Amnuna. I don't understand. Did you really just say that, that sons only inherit property from their father? So what if the father didn't own any real estate, but he had millions of dollars in the bank, they don't chop that around? So Amar le, Rav Yosef says of Yosef, viduma ksubas benin tichrin ko Amar mar. So Rav Yosef says, Rav Amnuna, maybe you're talking about ksubas benin tichrin. That, yeah, we didn't really talk much so far about the ksubas benin tichrin, but we're going to get up to it soon. But ksubas benin tichrin is basically that the sons inherit the ksuba of their mother as opposed to the ksuba of a different wife. So that is only collected from property, right? So for example, if you have Sara and Rivka, and they're married to Yaakov, and then with Sara there's, I don't know, Reuven and Shimon, and with Rivka they have just Levi. So if Sara and Rivka die, so then Yaakov inherits Sara and Rivka, and he inherits their ksubas, right? So now if Sara brought $1,000 into the marriage, and Rivka brought $1,000 into the marriage, Yaakov inherits both of that. And the ksubas benin dichrin means that when Yaakov then dies, so Reuven and Shimon would split their mother's ksuba, which was $1,000, so they each get $500, and Levi gets his mother's ksuba, which is the full $1,000, as opposed to saying that we divide $2,000 three ways. No, each one inherits their own mother's ksuba. That way, as we're going to learn, that way Sara and Rivka's fathers will be more willing to give a more substantial dowry, knowing that it's ultimately going to go to their grandchildren, and it's not going to be divided equal by all the sons from all the wives. Okay, so that is specifically collected from property. So that, right, so when we say that the sons inherit their father's property, but not metaltlin, that's talking about ksubas benin dichrin. But otherwise, of course, they inherit the bank account, soichet. So Omerle, so Rav Amnuna says to Rav Yosef, mar digabe rabu yodam ay kamina. Look, Rav Yosef, you are a great fellow, therefore you, of course, understood what I meant. Givaldik. So it's talking about the ksubas benin dichrin that is being collected by the Karka, fine. Omer b'chir bar Yosef, says b'chir bar Yosef, Rav zon mechite de aliyah. Says b'chir bar Yosef that Rav sustained orphan girls from the wheat, which is metaltlin. It's not karka, it's metaltlin. It's movable objects, it's not property. From the wheat of the aliyah. Now the question is, what is this aliyah? Ibaydu parnosa avya? Does it mean that Rav gave parnose to these girls, meaning that they, right, a dowry, that they wanted to get, that they were getting married, and Rav used this metaltlin to provide a dowry for them. Umay aliyah me iluya de'av, and what does it mean aliyah? It means from the sort of, generosity of the father. Uchud Shmuel, and like Shmuel, the Amr Shmuel, the parnose shaman ba'av, that when it comes to the dowry of an orphan girl, so we figure how much, you know, how generous was her father? How much would her father, if he was alive, how much would he have given for their dowry? And we provide a dowry based on what we project, her father would have, given as a dowry. Maybe it literally means food, right? Mazon. sustenance, and that Rav gave sustenance for these orphan girls from Mitaltalin, which would be not like Rav Amnuna said, which is that, right just now, which is that the Mizonis would only be from Karka. So, Umay Aliyah, so what does it mean, Aliyah, if it's referring to Mizonis? Midvarim Tov Mishnemu Ba'aliyah, from the good things that were said in the attic, to Amr of Yitzchak Bar Yosef Ba'aliyah Iskinu, that they enacted, they established in an attic, Sheyu Bonus Nizonis Min HaMitaltalin, that the orphan girls should be sustained, right, Mizonis, from Mitaltalin. So therefore, when it says that Rav gave from wheat, which is movable objects of the Aliyah, is it referring to a dowry? And it was based on Aliyah, based on how much we project the generosity of her father would be. Or is it Aliyah from the thing that happened in the attic? And Aliyah is an attic. And that is that they said that orphan girls can be sustained and get mizonis from movable objects. Tashma. Coming here, b'yodid rabbanoi achva d'rabchir bar'aba avu metaltin d'yasme, that rabbanoi, the brother of Rabchir bar'aba, had movable objects of orphans. Also l'kame d'shmuel, and they came before Shmuel, Omar le, and he said to him, zil zon, sustain these girls from the metaltin, from these movable objects. So my love, limzones, what does it mean to sustain them? It must mean mizonis, that give them, provide for them mizonis from these movable objects. Uchud Rabbi Yitzchak Bar Yosef Svirle. And Shmuel holds like Rabbi Yitzchak Bar Yosef that you can sustain girls and give mizonis from the metaltlin. Lo, no, hos mifanos avoy. No, Shmuel was saying to provide a dowry from movable objects. Ushmuel the time, and Shmuel is consistent with his reasoning. To Omar, Shmuel the finos shaman ba'av, that Shmuel said that when it comes to parnose, that when it comes to a dowry, right, evaluate how much the father would have provided for the dowry and provide based on those projections. Hava uvdi ben Ardoya, there was an instance in Ardoya, v'don dayone din Ardoya, and the judges of Nahar Doya basically said that you can give mizonis, you can sustain orphan girls from movable objects. Now, interesting, the Dayone de Nahar Doya, so there's a Gemara in Sanhedrin and Daf Yudzayinim Abayis, which goes through all these like different titles, and it says over there that Dayone de Nahar Doya is Rav Adar Bar Manyomi. There you go. So I guess when it says Dayone din Ardo, it's talking about Rav Adar Bar Manyomi. Okay? Bepumpedisa, Ve'agbe Rav Chana Bar Bizna, and a similar situation happened in Pumpedisa, and Rav Chana Bar Bizna provided mizonis for these orphan girls from movable objects. Omru Rav Nachman said to them, Zilo Ahaju, go and take back what you did, that you provided for the mizonis from this movable objects, v'ilo, and if you don't take it back, magbina l'chula apadnaichu minaichu, I'm going to take your mansions away from you. Seems like Rav Nachman was not into them taking stuff from the metaltalin. Yeah. Janine, maybe this fits into your what's the word? Ha'ara that you had on Sugya Sisters about Rav Nachman being a replacer, that he's going to replace the metaltalin with their mansions. Let's go weiter. Rav Asi, sorry, the mezim of metaltalin. That Rabbi Amin, Rabbi Asi thought to sustain orphan girls with movable objects. Omru Rabbi Yaakov Bar Idi. Rabbi Yaakov Bar Idi said to them, "Milsa Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Shlakish lo avduba uvda." Right, something that Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Shlakish were not willing to do. Right, to sustain orphan girls with movable objects. Atun avdin ba uvda. What, you're going to do that? Rabbi Lozer sovel the mezim imtatlin. Rabbi Lozer thought to sustain these orphan girls from movable objects. Omar Lefonov, right, movable things. Omar Lefonov, Reb Shimon ben Eliyakim. So Reb Shimon ben Eliyakim says to Reb Elazar, Rebbe, Yodea ani b'cha, Shein midas adin ata osa el midas rachmanas. Look, I know that you're only doing this because you have mercy on these girls, but elo shema yiru atamidim v'yikbu alach ledoris. But if you do this, then the students might see and interpret your actions to mean that this is the alache, that we give mizonis to orphan girls from metaltalin. But that isn't the halacha, so it's probably better that you don't do that. Haida so the comment of Yosef, there was a girl who came before of Yosef, Amalu, and he said to them, Havala mitamri de al budjo, give her from his onus from dates that are on the mats. That I guess when it comes time to harvest the dates, they put mats under the trees, and then there are dates that are on these mats, and I guess it's metaltlin. So basically Rav Yosef was saying that give him his onus from metaltlin. Omele Abai says to Yosef, Ilu bal chovavo, ki agavnu miyavo yoivle. I don't understand. If this was a creditor, so then, right, and he was looking to get paid back, would you pay him back from metaltlin? Of course not. So why are you paying, why are you allowing them to collect mizonos from metaltlin? So Omele, so says Rav Yosef, Tabai, the chazi levudjo ka'amina. No, I don't mean the ones that are actually on the mats and are actually movable and are actually metaltlin, but rather the ones that are about to fall and about to go onto the mats. So it's not actually metaltlin yet. They're still on the trees, so they're considered karka. But sof kol omid ligzos kigozos domi. But anything that's however, says Abai, anything that's going to be harvested, it's like it's already harvested. So these dates that are mamish about to fall off the tree, they're already going to be considered like metaltlin. The tzrich ledikla kamino. So says of Yosef, no, the ones that still need the palm tree, i.e., they're not quite ripe yet, and therefore they're still considered like karka. And that is what Rav Yosef was suggesting for mizonis of these orphan girls. Friends, that was Daf Nun of Masechta Ksubis. The first Amud had like some interesting stuff about tzedakah. They shouldn't give more than 20% of your wealth away in tzedakah. We learned about ripping a kid's head off and force feeding him Torah like an ox. That was interesting. And then we talked about, right, the fellow who starts learning at a young age, it would be difficult for his kids to catch up to him. And then we talk about at the end that we say that the mizonis an orphan girl is sustained by comes from karka. It does not come from metaltlin. Friends, that was the afternoon of Masechta Ksubis. Hope you enjoyed. Peace out.